Hello everyone. So today we'll be talking about Facebook Hacker Cup Qualification Round 2020. This round was a 72-hour round. It began on 24th July 2020 at 10:30 p.m. IST and it ended on 27th July at 10:30 p.m. IST. This round consisted of 5 questions, as you can see here. Out of them, had correctly solved 3 questions and got a wrong answer in the fourth question, which gave me a total score of 46 out of 100 and a rank of 1650 out of 32,000 participants. And you can see the rule here: to advance to round 1, you must have solved at least one problem in this round. I had solved 3, so I advanced to the first round. Okay, so in this video I'll be discussing the problems I had officially solved during the round, which were problems A, B and C. So let's start with problem A. This is problem A, travel restrictions. You may pause the video and read the problem statement first. Okay, as we can see the input, we'll be given the number of test cases, we'll be given 2 arrays, the incoming and outgoing array and the length of that array. The constraints are test cases can be up to 100. And the length of array can be between 2 and 50, inclusive of both. So we can easily do it in n square. Okay, so what is the problem? There are 2 arrays, the incoming and outgoing array. For each array, every character is either a y or an n. For array I, if it is y, if a character is y, that means the station, the airport at that index is allowed for incoming flights, and outgoing flights are allowed if the character of array O is Y. And if it is N, incoming is not allowed. If it is N in O, then outgoing is not allowed from that airport. Okay, so let's start solving the problem. As you can see, I have my template ready. This template is for quick and fast output. As you know, sometimes input in Python can be a little long. So I've made input functions, and fast input is also applied in this template. You can download this template from the description box. I'll provide the link over there. Okay, so let's take the input first. There we have to take the number of test cases. I have already taken it in my template. As you can see, the variable t. For each test case, we will solve. So let's complete the solve function. First, there is an integer n. Then there are 2 arrays, incoming and outgoing. We name them for ease, array A and B. Okay, so here, as we can see, what is the output? Output is a 2D array of size n into n. Okay, so let's create a blank 2D array or an initial 2D array filled with all n's. So let's name that 2D array answer. So answer equals n into n for I in range n. We'll be using list comprehension for this. Okay, so what logic I'll be using? First, I'll be traversing for each index. For each index, I'll see, means I'll take that index as the starting point, and I'll try to see, suppose you see this variable y, this is at the fourth position. So I'll try to see whether a flight starting from this fourth position, how far can it go towards the right side? If it can go up, let's consider if it can go only up to 8, then we obviously know that it cannot go further than 8, because it has stopped at 8, because either incoming is not allowed at 9 or outgoing is not allowed from 8. So we cannot go further from 8. The same thing we'll be doing from a position to the left side also. So first let's do for the right side. This will be a nested loop. I in range n. Okay, there's a typo here. And for j in range, we'll be starting from that index and go extreme towards the right. Okay, so if I and j are same, that means from as we can see here, if I equals j, the answer is always yes. Means it's just a base case that you can always go from the same airport to the same airport, obviously without taking a flight. So if I equals j, answer of I j is y. Okay, so and the next case is if I equals j and outgoing is not allowed from that airport, that means we immediately need to break there. If bj equals n, we'll immediately break. That means we cannot go anywhere from that airport. So the rest of that array will be n. The next is if I is not equals to j and incoming at that airport is allowed, so we can go to that airport obviously. So answer of I and j will be a yes. And if I is not equals to j and incoming is not allowed at that airport, so we'll break the. Now see here, if incoming is allowed at an airport but outgoing is not allowed from that airport, so we have already done answer from I to j will be yes for that. That means you can go from I to j but you cannot go anywhere further than j. So if b of j, that means if outgoing at an airport is not allowed, that means if it is n, we'll again have to break it. This was quite a simple logic. You'll have to read it one or two more times if you don't understand. As I told you, we'll do it for both sides. We have traversed from the airport to the extreme right. Now we'll traverse from the airport to the extreme left. For that, we'll do -1, -1, so that it will traverse from I in the reverse order up to 1, up to 0 to be precise. Now we have our answer array ready. So what we'll do, we'll print it. How is printing done here? First we'll have to print a case. So let's do this. Print case hashtag plus the test case number. String of the test case is stored in variable tt, as you can see, and I have made that tt global, so we can access here tt plus 1 plus there is also a colon, and after the colon we'll have to print from the next line onwards. So how do we have to print? We'll have to print it in a string format. So we'll take a loop here for I in range n, and we'll print each array inside that 2D array. So and we'll have to join the character array to make it a string. So join of answer of I. I think our code is pretty much complete. So let's run this code. Submit for practice, download full grading input. Okay, I have downloaded the input. Okay, so in my code, at last there is an online judge which is now in debug mode. What is a debug mode? That means you can give input and you'll get the output in your terminal. This is good for debugging. You will give your input and output in the terminal itself, but for now we don't want it. We want file input output, so we'll do it not debug. Okay, so the program has been executed. We have got our output in output.txt. We need to submit this. Output is output.txt. My source code is qwfp.py. Now let's submit it. Processing your submission. Your submission is fully correct. Okay, so we have solved the first question. Now let's move on to the second question, that is problem B. Okay, so this is problem B, Alchemy. You may pause the video again and read the problem statement for yourself. Okay, so in the input we'll be given again the number of test cases, an integer n, and the length of a string, and we'll be given a string C. And let's look at the constraints. T is up to 95, n is up to 99999, and sum of n over all test cases is 1,000,000. That means we have to do it in O of n. We cannot go to O of n square in this case, otherwise we'll get a TLE. Okay, so what is the question here? We'll have a string like ABAB consisting of A's and B's. We can remove BAB to form just B. That means if we collect three consecutive strings, there will be one character which will occur two times and another character which will occur one time. Or there may occur three characters which are the same, but we don't need that string. We'll use only strings which have like this BAB or ABB or anything like that, AAB, etc., etc. So this was a simple logic. That means you can see here AAB or BAB or ABA, AAB, BAA, these all these three strings will be converted into A. That means 1A and 1B is removed and only 1A is remaining, and in the strings such as BBA, BAB and ABB, the strings AB are again removed and only B string remains. That means the problem boils down to only one fact, that we'll be removing 1A and 1B at a time. Okay, and at last only one character should remain. As we know, this is an odd length string. So if we can remove even numbers of A's and B's, at last only one character is left. So what is the logic? That means just count the number of A's and the number of B's. If the absolute difference between those two is 1, that means if there is 1A extra or 1B extra, at last we'll get this that single A or that single B to remain. And if it is something like BBB, how can we get A from here? And any operation can also not be performed in BBB. If there are 5 A's, if the number of A's minus the number of B's is 5, that means removing 1A and 1B, 1A and 1B, at last 5 A's will remain. But we only want one character to remain. So in that case, the answer will be N. So let's code this. First, we need the integer N. Then we need a string S. And just we'll check if absolute of S dot count A minus s dot count b, if the absolute value of this is 1, answer will be yes, else answer will be no. Now we'll print this. different case. Okay, so I think our code is pretty much ready. So we need to submit this. Okay, so let's copy this into our input.txt. Okay, so our program is compiled. We have got output.txt. Now we just need to submit this. Our source code is qw.py, qwfp.py. We'll just submit this. Your submission is fully correct. Yeah, so we got 15 points for this. And we had already got 10 points from the previous question. Now we'll move on to the third question, which is problem C. Okay, so this is the third problem, problem C, timber. You may pause the video and read the problem statement. It is quite a large problem statement, so make sure you read it carefully. Okay, so you must have read the problem statement. Okay, there are many trees planted and height of each tree is given and the position of each tree also. And we need to cut down all the trees or not all, we need to cut down all the trees and we need to find the longest connecting chain. This was a bit complex. The ideology was a bit complex when I started solving it first, and I think this complexity is the reason that problem C consisted even more points than problem D. Okay, so I need to explain this using drawing. So let's open something like Paint. Yeah. Okay, so my logic is that first, if the trees are given in sorted, if the trees even aren't given in a sorted fashion, that means from left to right, we'll just use a dot sort for doing that. So I guess we have got the trees in a sorted manner. After that, first in my logic, I fell the trees from the left towards the right side. Then this tree will look something like this. If this tree falls, this will look something like this. If this tree falls down, this will look something like this. First, I make sure that all the trees fall to the same, that is towards the right side. This falls at this point. And this falls like this. Okay, so first we need, if all the trees are fallen towards the right, we'll get few connecting chains. As you can see, this is a connecting chain. This is another connecting chain, but these two are not connected as there is gap between these two. And again, we'll do this thing for the right side. That means we'll assume that the trees, every tree falls to the right side. Like this. Yeah, so again we'll get connecting chains. We may not get connecting chains. This is a connecting chain. This is an overlapping chain. That means this length will obviously surpass this, so this isn't needed. This is a single tree chain, so the connected chain is these two trees. Okay, so the main complicated thing, I don't know if I'll be able to explain correctly or not, nicely or not. Okay, So you need to understand this, that at max there will be only one point in the whole chain where a tree has fallen, that one from to the left side, the tree has fallen in this fashion, and the tree on the other side has fallen from the right. Rest all, starting from this point towards the left side, all the trees will be falling from the left towards the right side. And here also, all the trees will be falling from the right towards the left side. There will be at max only one point where one tree is falling from one side and another tree is falling from the other side. You need to understand this. Obviously, there will be no more points in that longest connecting chain where this thing will happen. So my idea is based on this fact only. So let's code this. I'll also explain in between while coding. I'll draw and explain during coding. Okay, so let's see the inputs. First, the number of test cases, we have already taken it, then n. Okay, so we'll be given n lines, each of them contain p and h. We can easily do it using a 2D list. We'll create a blank list. We'll take p comma h, p comma h, and we'll append it as a list, such that it looks like a, not looks, it is a list of lists. And as I told you, we are doing it from left side to right side, from right side to left side, and the trees here may not be given in a sorted position from left to right. That means increasing to decreasing. So we need to sort this. I'll do that by using a dot sort. Okay, so my logic is that I'll be using, okay, so try to understand this, that suppose there is a point and a tree has fallen up to that point. That means that is an end point. Let's mark it, suppose 5. Okay, and this point was 2, and the length of this tree is 3. And at position 0, there was one tree of length 2. It had also fallen. So at end point 2, the length of the chain is 2. At end point 2, the length of the chain up to 2 is 2. Now, if we go ahead from 2, at point 5, the length of the chain is this 3 which has fallen plus the preceding chain, which is 2. This might get a little complicated, so let's try to code this. We'll be keeping two dictionaries for this. Dictionary in we'll be given keeping first a dictionary, q is equals to dict for this, and the key of the dictionary will be the endpoint, and the value will be the length of the chain preceding, that means towards the left side, which is connecting up to that point 2. As I go on coding, I think you'll be able to understand this. So we have created a blank dictionary. Dictionary is a data structure which has a key value pair. It is called map in C++, if there are C++ users here. So we'll go from left to right for I in range n. Okay, so notice one thing. We need the endpoint. So how we'll get the endpoint? We need to do something like this. Q of the, as we know, AI will give me a list consisting of P and H. That means this is a 2D list. So how do we get this endpoint 2? This will be Q of A of I of 0. That means the position plus the height, a of I of 1. 0 plus 2, And what will be the value for this? This the value will be the height, that means a of I of 1. But we also need to keep a check of preceding points. Suppose we reached 5, so what it will do, a of 2 plus 3, that is a of 5, that means at 5 there is just a preceding chain of 3. But we also need to remember that there are preceding chains starting from point 2 itself. So first we'll check if point 2 is in the dictionary. So if a of I of 0 in Q, we'll keep a check, that means if it is present, then present equals the value of that, that means Q of a of I of 0. And if it's not present, we'll keep that, that means there are no chains preceding that point, so P will be 0. So the answer will not be just a of I of 1, it will be P plus a of I of 1. I hope you get this. This is not quite difficult. Now there is one more thing, that at point 5 there are, okay, so this was a chain of length 5 ending at point 5. Suppose there was one more point, means there was one more chain which ended at point 5. Okay, suppose at minus 50 there is a chain, suppose at minus 50 there is a chain, there is a tree of length 55. This will also point, this will also fall on 5. So for 5 as an endpoint, we have two chains of length 5 and of length 55. So we also need to check that if a of I of 0 plus a of I of 1, that means that if that endpoint is in the dictionary, we will take another, means we'll take a just a value, suppose m for that max. If it is present, it will be q of a of I of 0 plus a of I of 1. And if it's not present, we just keep it m equals 0, and the new value will be, it will not be just this, it will be max of m comma this new thing, so that we always get the longest chain. Obviously we need the longest chain as an answer, so we are doing this so that we get the longest chain. So we have done for the tree falling, for each, suppose for each tree which is falling right side, means we have assumed that all the trees are falling from left towards the right in this. Now we also need to do the opposite thing, that means we'll assume that all the trees, each and every tree, is falling from the right side towards the left side. So we name that W, and all the Q's will become W's here. Okay, and one more thing, we need to do this in O of N, and searching in a dictionary in Python is always O of 1, it is not O of log N. Searching if a key is present in a dictionary or not is always O of 1 in Python. Okay, so I think the second part is also pretty much ready. Okay, let's clear this thing a bit. Okay, I need to. Okay. Yeah. So if a tree is falling from the left hand side towards the right hand side, there are other trees which are falling from the right hand side towards the left hand side. Yeah. So what do we need to check here? We need to check if there is an endpoint which is common in both our dictionaries and in the keys of both the dictionaries. We need to check this thing. If we got an endpoint which is common in the left hand side dictionary as well as the right hand side dictionary. That means we can add those both chains and there will be the longest chain and we'll get a longer chain. There may be more than one endpoint. That means there may be an endpoint here also. There may be two small trees which are falling like this and like this. That means only two chains are falling and there is an endpoint which is common here. Yeah. So there may be more than one endpoints which are common in both. So for both endpoints, we need to add up the values of both the from both the dictionaries. Suppose at endpoint 5, suppose there is an endpoint 5 in the first dictionary, and for that key the value is 20. Okay, and for the right hand side as well, there is a key 5, and for that the length is suppose 40. So we need to add these both, 20 plus 40. So we'll get a longer chain which is 60. Hope you get this. And one more thing, we'll be traversing, and when we are going from the right hand side towards the left hand side, we'll be traversing in a reverse manner. So n minus 1 up till minus 1. Yeah. And there are more corrections, that this will be a of i of 0 minus a of i of 1. That means if a tree is at 20 and if it is falling towards the right hand side from the left towards the right hand side, and if its length is 5, the endpoint will be 15, not 25. So we need to do this as minus. This will be p because we are just adding the length of chains, so do not make this minus. Okay, so now let's check the common keys in both the dictionaries. So for that we'll take an array common. So first we need to get the keys. We'll get those by k dot q dot keys. We'll convert it as a list first. List of q dot keys and intersection with list. Actually, we have to make it a set first, because intersection, union, all these things are applicable to sets, not for lists. So we need to convert this also as a set first. First, okay, we also need to get the keys as a list. So I think this is done. One more. Okay, we have an ending bracket extra here. Okay, so we have got our common. So we have got our common keys as a list. So what do we need to do now? We will calculate the values which are present in both. We'll take it as an answer array. So answer will be q of c of I plus w of c of I for I in range length of c. Okay, yeah, so I think this is done. And one more thing, there may be zero points which are common in both the dictionaries. That means there may be a case where no point is coinciding in both the dictionaries. So for that we'll just use the maximum values of q and w. So plus list of q dot values plus list of w dot values. So I think our code is pretty much complete. So in our answer, we'll get all those values. We need to print the maximum of all those values. So print of case. Max of answer. Yeah, so I think our code is pretty much complete. I have coded this in one go, so I don't know if there are problems such as syntax errors or anything like that. So we'll do it not debug. So now we need to debug this. Okay, there is some error. Okay, so for the next time it will be W not Q in the second part. Okay, so let's see. 9, 9, 6, 6, 12, 33, 80, 56, and I think this is 1 billion. Yeah, so I think our code is pretty much complete. This was a bit complex. If you have any doubt, you can ask in the comment section. I'll always reply. Okay, so we need to download the input file. Okay, so our code is completed and we have got put.txt. okay, I think there has been some error. Okay, so I downloaded the sample input. Okay, so the input has been downloaded. Okay, so we'll save it in input.txt. Yeah, it's saved. So yeah, so we have our output.txt ready. This took a bit long because we had sorted that array, so it gave a complexity of n log n, which that's why it took a bit of time. We need to upload this output.txt. Our source file was qwfb and we submit this. Processing your submission. Yeah, your submission is fully correct. So that's how you solve problem C, timber. I tried to solve problem D1 during the contest, but it had given me a wrong answer, and the reason for that was sum of n across all jobs was, that means we had to do it in O of n because the constraint of sum sigma n was 4 million. So, and my logic went up to m into n, which obviously would have given TLE. So to avoid that, I calculated the time. If the time for that test case was taking more than 5 seconds, I just exited from the loop and directly printed -1. So obviously it would have given me a wrong answer for those test cases, which were these 3 test cases. My output was -1, but the answer is obviously not -1. and the rest all were quite good, in which the input was not that large. For these test cases, obviously, it would have given minus 1. It would have given a wrong answer. Okay, so that's how you solve the three problems, first three problems of the qualification round. Okay, so if you like the video, please do like and subscribe to my channel. Okay, thank you.